This is our discussion. If you have any questions, please let me have a try to answer.
Naresh, whenever the executors got created, right, on the worker nodes, so so it will create only on the nodes which the particular data will available, or any worker nodes will it get created, executors?
He's talking?
Yeah, this is Pawan, Naresh.
Yeah, okay. Okay, Pawan. So it's a good question. Yeah. See, data is available in multiple nodes, right? That you know very well, right?
Yes, yes.
So what it will do, to reduce the network bandwidth, first of all, a cluster or a resource manager is smart enough to build, and that is very near to your submission, where you are submitting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So yeah, if due to some reason, the data is there one machine, but unfortunately it is occupied with the other jobs, then what it will do, it will try to see another copy. In HDFS, right, when we use HDFS, we have three copies in by default, right?
Yeah.
Right? So it will go to another machine where that data is resides.
Okay.
That means ultimately it will try to create or provide resources very closer to your submission, where you are submitting.
Okay.
Based on the resource availability. Okay, so that it will try to reduce the network consumption or network bandwidth.
Okay, first of all, it will look for the nearest one. If it is not available, then it will go for the another worker nodes.
Correct.
Which are of replicate copies.
Yeah. There are multiple scenarios it will check, because based on the resource availability, also you're supposed to check, right? Not only distance. So, but the steps will be follow like this: nearest, and then available. I mean, available nothing but nearest data availability, and then more resource availability. This kind of check they can do.
Okay. Yeah. Got it. Yeah.
Is this clear? Whatever I'm explaining so far, how internal is Spark Java?
Yes, Naresh. And one more doubt.
Yeah.
So generally, when executors they are doing any process like reading any data, are they doing from the storage system, or the data being copied to worker nodes first, then process the data?
That's what I'm telling you. First of all, let us say your data is there in our worker nodes. Let us say you are using HDFS. Okay. So when you are working HDFS with Spark, what will happen? Definitely our data should be there in our any of the machine, right? Right?
Yes.
So first of all, it will give the priority for that machine. If not available, then second copy where it got loaded, it will go to that machine. If the machine is having some available resources, then it will allocate. Okay, let us say three machines it checked by wherever the data, but unfortunately it didn't get the resources. What it will do? It will do, like, it will pick, it will try to take the data. Yeah, and you know, place the data into different machine where most resources are available. But again, it will take little time, and the data should travel to the another machine through you know, some secure cells, right? SFTP, or we have some connections, right? It will create some network issues. Okay, application may run little more time than we expected due to this issue.
More disk IO will happen, Naresh.
Correct. Correct.
Understood.
Yeah. Any questions?
So, Naresh, whenever the executor got failed, so DAG is responsible, or who is responsible to track that job?
See, here, the Spark, I don't know how many you are aware Impala. So, when you have a knowledge in Impala, then definitely you may ask one question like, Impala is also working on memory, and Spark is also working on memory. Okay, by using memory, you can say. But how come people are Spark is more popular than Impala, right? So there are some internal feature which are providing by the Spark, but not providing by the Impala. Okay, that is the reason Spark is very popular than any other tools, right? Not only you know, based on the only many tools which are using RAM, but still why Spark is popular? Because of some other advantage there with the Spark, right? We have fault tolerance. okay, mm-hmm. In Spark, like you know, we can ask if you have such kind of issues, if you have such type of doubts, then generally we can do the persist the data, right? So that is one option. Even if you don't have the persistence, then what, due to that DAP, what it will do, it will try to Spark master, Spark cluster manager smart enough to pick one more executor and assign this task to it. Okay, and but thing is, again it will redo from the beginning. Okay, based on the DAG. Okay, so other executors got completed, Spark manager, or we can say Spark cluster manager will supposed to wait till this executors complete this task. Okay, that will be happen, but nothing more will be happen than this. Okay.
So Naresh, if we created app, so until unless we'll disconnect from the session, those executors will under this particular job, or will they get released?
No, it will release once we submit output results set to the cluster manager or driver, then the automatically the worker notes will be released.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Naresh, I have a question. Is there any scenario happens like suppose the partition data is more than the memory which is supposed to be processed in Spark? So is there any scenario will be happened in those?
Yes, of course. That is a very much valid scenario. We face several times, but we have some serialization. We have some disk only, memory and disk serialization. We have some methods are there, right? Do you know the concepts? We will cover in upcoming sessions. You don't need to worry. So Spark is have a very good feature. That is, if you feel or if you doubt, sometimes in the future, if data comes huge, then if a cluster is not viable or not having the sufficient resources, in that time definitely our job will get failed due to memory out of exception error. Okay. In that case, how to handle? That may be the question. So in that case, if you have such kind of problem, or if you already find in future if we may face this kind of scenario, then definitely I can recommend you to go to disk kind memory serialization. So that what it will do, let us say your data set is 1 GB, but whereas available resources are 500 MB or 700 MB, but what about 300 MB data? Where it will go? That means Spark good enough. When you explicitly specify you have to use this method, then what it will do, that 700 MB will be processed in RAM or memory, and the remaining 300 MB will be processed in disk. That is how you can overcome that memory out of exception error. Okay, this is one of the most important interview question.
But in that case, the execution will be slower, right? When we process in disk.
Of course. But you tell me, that is better, right? That is little better, right? Than the going our job into error state, right? You know one thing, Spark is almost 10 times more faster than MapReduce, even compared to disk. And of course, 100% or say 100% faster than MapReduce when we are working on memory. Okay, you people may have one doubt: how come Spark is 10% faster than the MapReduce when we Spark also uses the disk? Okay, this might be the question, but definitely we'll explain in an upcoming session. Okay, due to the several features which are available in Spark, that is possible. Okay. So still it is considerable, right? As compared to MapReduce. Got it?
Yeah.
Guys, any questions? If not, we shortly discuss. I didn't prepare any notes for the next topic, but still I want to give you an overview on another important topic. Shall we go ahead?
Yes, Naresh. Yeah, we can go.
Yeah, yes, Naresh. You can go ahead.
I think a few days ago, I already discussed about the dev environment, SD environment, and PT and the production. Okay. So this is fine. This is limited to the Spark, how Spark works internally when we submit any application. But coming to actual project execution, most of the people, a few might don't have the practical because of, you know, you might take any coaching or you might go on to the only theoretical concept, or you didn't do the projects much in big data. So that time, you know, you might, I guess you might not have the practical experience how real time workflow will be happen. Okay. Let's assume the first one is development and this is the testing environment and this is performance tuning, that is PTL environment, and this is the production. Okay, just as a nice, just try to understand. I'll give you some more insight. Development environment and testing, RQA and PT, performance tuning, or in performance testing, you can say, and finally production. So there might be a one more environment, that is DR, disaster recovery, but it is optional. It will be you know, company to company will manage. Okay, it's not. But these are the general environment which we generally use in our real time project execution. Okay. So what will happen? Just now we discussed in the beginning, right? How we get the project and how the task will be assigned to the respective team members or team leads, and how will be sprints will be executed. Okay, so let us assume we got one project and a deadline or project completion period, we can say 6 months. So we have two teams, each team having one team lead as well as one project manager and one scrum master, and then total 8 developers and one architect. Okay. Those may be the we have the team. Okay, so scrum master is one, project manager is second, and architect is third. Okay, I'm not including product owner, which is client. Okay, and 8 developers, that means total 11. Okay, let us assume like that you have 11 members as a team and want to develop an application and complete in 6 months. Okay, by using Agile methodology. So for that we have a scrum master or project manager will try to allocate the tasks. Okay, and they divided let us say I can say this is the first month and the second month, okay, and third month, something like that. Okay, and so on and so on. Okay, so in this again I can say our sprint may be from 1 week to 10 days or 15 days also. Let us assume we have one sprint, two sprints in our, month, per month. Okay. We have two sprints. Okay. And each sprint, we have two teams. Anyway, they have to work. Okay. Now, each sprint, we have multiple tasks. Okay. We can say this is the sprint. Okay. S1, SP1. Sprint one and then sprint two, something like that. Okay, assume like that. And this is the M1. M1 means month one. Okay, and this is the M6. Now we have a sprints like this, and months we have 6. Each sprint, right? Each sprint, we have multiple tasks. Okay, task 1, 2, 3, 4. Let us assume 4 tasks we have. Okay, 4 tasks we have, 2 teams. Okay, 2 teams means each team we have 4 members. You just exclude the team lead. Team lead also will participate, but thing is, he will try to resolve the any issues if he face, okay, by the developers. So each, let us say each task, two developers are doing one task, okay? We can just assume like that. Then our scope is two developers will do, or if you have eight tasks, then eight people will do. If you have four tasks, one task will be divided into two modules, and each module will be developed by the one each developer, okay? Then they have to submit by the end of this sprint. That means 15 days sprint. Here, sprint is 15 days. It could be 1 week, 10 days, 15 days, okay, or 3 weeks as a maximum. But in our case, we're just using 2 weeks. Okay. So let us assume the two people got taken one task and completed the task in 15 days. 15 days means we again in 15 days, right? What we will do, we will try to divide the task one, two people, two developers, we can say. And what they will do, analysis. And analysis they will do, then mapping. Analysis means technical documentation, whatever the provided by the architects, okay? And then they will do the mapping columns from where we have to get this data, something like that. Then development, you can say code development, okay? Then unit testing, okay? Then hand over to the testing team. Okay, these are the phases that we generally follow. Okay, one task, two developers are doing this kind of work in 15 days. Like that, every 15 days, definitely we used to get the more tasks, then again we have to submit. So we will develop all these codes. Okay, let us say we have a two teams, right? Then we have a four tasks, four codes, we can say four jobs. Okay, they developed four jobs. Okay, in development environment, they have did the unit testing and all. It seems it is fine. Now what it will do? The Scrum Master or Project Manager, they will discuss and they will send it to the testing team. Okay, this mapping will be created. Then mapping as well as the code will be code. Sometimes we share in but based on the mapping details will be shared to testing team or QA team. Then what they will do? They will do the they will try to execute the test cases whatever they have created for this respective job, and they will try to start working on the testing. So testing team will do the testing in testing environment. Okay, I explained how many cores or how many the cluster, how will be the cluster in dev, how will be the cluster in testing, PT, and prod. In our previous sessions, if you do not have the knowledge or didn't have the idea, please. I recommend you to go through the previous videos and get the knowledge and then come back here. Okay. So now testing will do the testing. If the all test cases will be passed, then it will move to PT, where we will test our performance, how much time it is taking, what may be the expected time, something like that. And again, the testing team, if they find any bugs or any data mismatch, again, they will raise a ticket to the dev team. The dev team supposed to resolve that issue and send it back to the testing for the necessary testing. Okay, let us assume they have closed the ticket by giving the proper solution, and then the testing team again tested that they found the data is now looking good. Then what they will do, they will send it for UAT, a user acceptance test. Okay, that means client or product owner. Okay, product owner or the client will try to review if they satisfy with the data and performance, and then they will give the user acceptance test. After doing user acceptance test, they will give an approval. Okay, once we get the approval, after anyway we already completed the performance testing for the respective jobs, and then we have to create one CRQ, okay, to deploy our course. Okay, I'm just telling you, once we complete all these modules, then we will create a CRQ and take the proper approvals from the respective authorities. Then we have to develop, we have to submit, we have to dump all our code okay, to the respective folders, okay, to the respective folders in production, and then we have to create some you know, jobs or workflows, or you know, and we have to attach to schedulers that jobs. Okay, and then there is another team who will monitor all these jobs. So they will try to schedule the jobs based on our inputs. So what time we have to run, and what is the interval of the job? All the details we have to mention and submit the request to the respective scheduling tool managers. So probably I told you, right? Airflow or Oozie or Redwood, generally we are using in real time. So there are some administrators are there for each tool. We have to submit our request with all the necessary information to them so that they will try to schedule it. Okay. Now, you know, if it is an existing application, we have to place our new jobs or new project and in place of old, then they will ask for downtime. Okay, downtime for you know, hours or days. So by the time the existing flow, whatever is there, will be stopped, and the new system will be deployed in a production. Then once successful deployment, then our jobs will be executed. Okay, this is the little high level you know, flow when we work in a real time. Okay, how we submit an application, or how a project will go into the live is these many steps we supposed to follow. Okay, I'm not including my new steps because this much knowledge is, I think, is sufficient. And as you go ahead, definitely you will get bit more knowledge in depth. And but this much knowledge we have to have if you are showing as a experienced person. Okay, guys, any questions?
No, so far is good.
I didn't go to deeper because when you do some real-time mini project, at least you come to know more details. But this is how in real-time we generally follow. But again, I'm telling you, these scenarios may be little here and there based on the company to company and the project requirement to requirement. But this may be the, you know, standard way of executing a project. So yeah, you have to have this knowledge. Okay, guys. I think that's it. The topic I just want to cover, these two topics today. So in these sessions, we can say. So, you have any questions from our topics which we completed just now, or if you don't have any questions, then if you have any other open questions, that also will be try to. Discuss.
Naresh, this is Hari here. Okay, when are you going to start next class?
Actually, you know, these are all free sessions.
Okay.
I'm not conducting as of now any courses or training because I'm just having some busy schedule.
Okay, sure.
So, but very soon, probably in 1 or 2 months, we'll try to start course. But please attend every weekend, just explaining Saturday, Sunday, right? So,
okay. Okay, sure.
Someday, like in 1 or 2 months, definitely we may cover majority of the topics, right, by that time.
Okay, yeah, got it. Thank you.
Hi, Naresh, this is Kumar. I'm just asking a question. It's an interview perspective. Like, it's an you can answer like ideally. See, if we got a question like how many members, how many developers and are in your project, including onsite. In if you got a question like this, then how can we answer such kind of questions? I mean, it's depends on project to project, but ideally, is there any?
Okay. So you got knowledge from this session, then you have some idea,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
You can explain.
Yeah,
this.
Yeah.
Okay, our project is, let us say, 1 year. We have three teams. I just explained two teams because it is 6 months project. If it is a 1 year project, just tell that three teams or four teams. We have each team, we have three to four members. excluding excluding technical tech lead. Okay. Again, on site we have very less. Hardly for each team we can say we have three or four members. One is a project manager over there and scrum master from on site, and then some on site lead also is there. Okay. But on site team is very less as compared to offshore team. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Naresh.
Yeah, no problem. Well, I think we do not have any questions. Guys, I think it is good to close the discussion. I will try to come up with another topic next week. If you have any requirements or any specific topics that you want to look for in the future, I will try to cover those as well. Such topics that you are looking for. I know two topics are already, discussed, and a few topics people still are asking. So definitely that will be discussed. Other than that, if you have any other problems, then please share here or not. If not possible, then you can also share in our WhatsApp group, official WhatsApp group, where I will try to see and try to take up the topic if it is.